In the previous main lecture video on steady-state engineering devices, link below, we went over pipe flow, nozzles, diffusers, and throttling devices. In this lecture, the second of that three-lecture series, we will learn about turbines, compressors, and pumps. If you want to learn about heat exchangers and mixing chambers, I'll leave the link to it down in the description of this video. Devices that either require work or produce work as a result of the change in temperature and pressure include turbines and compressors or pumps. Compressors and pumps both raise the pressure of the substance. The main difference between them is that the compressor compresses a gas and the pump increases the pressure of a liquid. Both compressors and pumps require work to operate to achieve that change in pressure. Turbines, on the other hand, take those changes in temperature and pressure to produce work. Of course, in the case of turbines, the change in pressure means that the exit pressure is lower than the inlet pressure, the complete opposite of compressors and pumps. Turbines take that potential energy in the form of temperature and pressure and transform it into mechanical work in the form of shaft work specifically. The mechanical details of how turbines work and how even electricity can be produced as the product of this shaft work are studied in other courses. For a thermodynamics course like this, we will only be interested in calculating how much work a turbine can produce. The reason we draw turbines like a diffuser is because there is a pressure decrease and therefore an expansion of the fluid, while also causing changes to the fluid's velocity. Turbines can also take into consideration the change in gravitational potential energy, for example, if the turbine is located at a dam. This is the reason for us usually drawing turbines with the inlet at a higher elevation than the exit. Taking all of this into consideration, and like the other devices we've seen so far where the change of energy over time is zero, and adding to that that the ideal turbines are very well insulated and therefore the heat transfer rate is zero, the conservation of energy equation reduces to work rate, W dot, equal to mass flow rate times the change in enthalpy, speed, and height. In cases where we know that changes in speed and head are negligible, this expression becomes just mass flow rate times the change in enthalpy. And of course, for the compressor, we have almost the exact opposite. A nozzle type schematic, large inlet area and small exit, with a mass flow coming in at the bottom and exiting at the top. We neglect the same terms as the turbine, and the work will result in the same exact expressions, with and without the kinetic energy and potential energy terms. Notice that the expression is identical, there's no additional negative signs. This is because in the case of turbines, since the thermal energy was converted into work, meaning the exit enthalpy is lower than the inlet, the work rate term, W dot, is positive. And from our convention for work, we know that positive work translates into work coming out of the control volume, which in fact is consistent with the turbine producing work. In the case of compressors, the opposite is true. We are using work to increase pressure and temperature, which means that the exit enthalpy is greater than the inlet enthalpy. This subtraction therefore results in a negative value for W dot, which again is consistent with our convention for negative work, meaning adding work into our system. For pumps, we use a circle for the device, mass coming in, mass coming out, work coming in, and after neglecting the same terms as before, with the turbine or the compressor, we see that the expression is also the same. However, in the case of a pump, where the substance is in the liquid phase, the difference is that the equation won't be very helpful. The changes in temperature are very small, and if you remember from what we established in our specific heat's 12-minute lecture, link below, that the enthalpy for compressed liquids is a function of temperature only, the changes in enthalpy will be very small as well. Now, this doesn't mean that because of this, the change in enthalpy is zero, and therefore the work is zero. It just means that the work is small. That the work required to pump a liquid is much smaller than the work in other devices. Now, if we only look at the change in enthalpy found in compressed liquid tables, based on the change in temperature, we're not gonna get an accurate approximation. Since the enthalpy is U plus PV, and the differentiated form is dH equal to dU plus PdV plus VdP, and we're dealing with a liquid, which is usually an incompressible substance, when we integrate this, the change in enthalpy is the change in internal energy plus V times the change in pressure. Since the temperature change is close to zero, and the internal energy for an incompressible substance is a function of temperature only, like we stated in the incompressible substance lecture, the change in internal energy is close to zero, and therefore the change in enthalpy is the specific volume times the change in pressure. This all means that the work can be written as the mass flow rate times the specific volume times the change in pressure. Now, this specific volume can be the inlet one or the exit one. It doesn't matter. Since we're dealing with a liquid here and we're assuming incompressibility, both the inlet and the exit will have the same specific volume for our substance. Now let's look at an example where we have both a throttling device from the previous lecture, the first of the three lectures of this series I mentioned at the beginning of the video, and a turbine. If you want to watch other examples for turbines, pumps, or compressors, make sure to check out the links in the description below. A throttling device brings down a 0.3 kg per second flow of steam at 250 degrees Celsius and 1.4 megapascals to 1.1 megapascals before it enters a turbine. The turbine produces 95 kilowatts and exhausts the water at a pressure of 25 kilopascals. What is the exhaust temperature and what is the quality if saturated? As always, pause here and try to solve this problem yourself before watching the solution. Let's call the inlet of the throttling device state 1, the exit of the device and therefore the inlet of the turbine state 2, and the exit of the turbine state 3. This shows us that we can most easily solve this problem with two control volumes, one around the throttling device and one around the turbine. What we know about the throttling device is that the inlet and exit enthalpy values are assumed to be the same, as you already know from the previous lecture and several example videos. So if we know the inlet temperature, we can find the inlet enthalpy, and this is also going to be the value for the exit enthalpy. And for the turbine, from what we learned today, the power output is the mass flow rate times the change in specific enthalpy, H2 minus H3. Since what we want to find is the exhaust temperature, and the temperature is directly related to enthalpy, what we really want to find is H3, the exhaust specific enthalpy of the turbine. So let's start with the throttling device. Quickly check in for saturated mixture tables, temperature or pressure, we see that for a pressure of 1.4 megapascals, the saturation temperature is 195.04. Since the temperature at state 1 is higher than this, we know that the water is at a superheated vapor phase. The same conclusion can be drawn from looking at a saturated mixture tables for temperature. For a temperature of 250 degrees Celsius, the saturation pressure is 3976.2 kilopascals. Since the pressure at state 1 is way lower than that, the water coming into the throttling device is in a superheated vapor phase. So we go to our superheated vapor tables and look for a pressure of 1.4 megapascals and a temperature of 250 degrees Celsius to find that the specific enthalpy for that state is equal to 2927.9 kilojoules per kilogram. And as stated before, H2 equals to H1, so H2 is equal to this value as well. Now for the turbine, the work out is mass flow times the enthalpy change, and since the work output is given, we solve for H3. With the mass flow rate being 0.3 and the work output being 95 kilowatts, we find that H3 is equal to 2611 kilojoules per kilogram. If we go to our saturated liquid vapor tables again, which is what we usually do to know what phase our water is in, we find that for a pressure of 25 kilopascals, HF is 272 and HG is 2617. This means that our water that has a specific enthalpy between that of saturated liquid and that of saturated vapor at the exhaust of the turbine is a saturated liquid vapor mixture. This implies that the temperature is the saturation temperature at 25 kilopascals, which is 64.96 degrees Celsius, and that the quality, using the expression we derived in the quality main lecture video, link below, is equal to roughly 99.7%. If you want to check out other examples where we include compressors, pumps, and other examples with turbines, make sure to check out the links I added to the description of this video. You'll find the links to all the lectures of the Thermo course as well as other engineering courses there as well. Thanks for watching!